You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for it.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Good to see you this morning. TGIF, happy Friday to you. He's talking about how good of a father he is to us this morning. Just worship with me for a little bit. Yes, thank you, God. You're perfect in all of your ways. Hallelujah. Sister Jeanette, good morning, sweetheart. It's good to see you. God bless you and happy Friday. Hope you had a great week. God is perfect in all of his ways. Hey, Queda, good morning. It's good to see you. Happy Friday to you. God is perfect in all of his ways. Sister Sandy, good morning. It's great to see you. I love this song. Peace so unexplainable.
I can hardly think as you call me.
Yes, God is calling us deeper still. Deeper still. God is calling us, ladies. He's calling us to go deeper. He's a good father. Hallelujah. Come on, can we talk about the goodness of God this morning? And we get to know how good he is, and we understand how loved we are. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Come on. It's good to know that we are loved by him. Amen. Hey, Jerry Ann, good morning. It's good to see you, sweetheart.
And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Yes. Come on, God is perfect in all of his ways. Perfect in all of his ways. Hallelujah. Sister Cynthia, good morning, sweetheart. It's good to see you. It's who you are, who you are, who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. Come on, you know, it tells us that. I remember reading in the Bible, when Jesus asked Peter, well, he asked all the disciples, right? He says, do you know, who are they saying that I am? Hey, Sister Sheila, good morning. Who do they say I am? You know, and they were saying, some say you're a prophet, some say you're this, some say you're that. And then it was Peter who piped up. I love Peter. He piped up and he said, you know, you are the Christ. And so Jesus says, you're right. And let me tell you who you are, you know, and you are Peter, you are the rock. Hey, Kenyatta, good morning. And it's just, you know, it's a reminder to us that The only way that we are going to get to know who we are, ladies, is by getting to know who God is, right? He is our creator. He's the one who knows us better than we know ourselves. So in other words, trying to get to know who you are, trying to get to know who I am outside of God is a lost cause. The best way to know who we are is to get to know who he is. And the more we know who he is, the stronger we become in knowing that we are the blessed daughter, son of the Most High King. Amen. And that's what that song is. That song says, you know, God is perfect in all of his ways. You know, that's who he is. He's a good father. And I'm loved by this good father, by this God who is perfect in all of his ways. That is the only way. When we talk about knowing our worth, our identity, our value, right? It can only come in through knowing his worth, his value, his power, right? That's the only way. Hey, Sister Laura, good morning. So listen, good Friday morning, ladies. I don't see any guys on here yet. I just want to say how much I love you, how much I appreciate you. Thank you for being here this morning. I have been praying. I have been studying. And I just want to share a word with you today that I believe God has placed on my heart. But before I do that, let's go ahead and pray and just open up this atmosphere. You know, let the Holy Spirit know that we want him here, because I know he's already here. But we want him to know that we want him here. Amen. We always want the Holy Spirit to have his way. Somebody say that with me this morning. Holy Spirit, have your way. We don't want Anne's way. We don't want each of our own way. We want the Holy Spirit to have his way. And do me a favor, Sister Penny, good morning, sweetheart. It's good to see you, warrior. I'm glad to see you, beloved. Come on in and get this word, Sister Penny, so you can continue to push forth. Like I said to you yesterday, I think it was, there are people that God has assigned to you, beloved, and you got to keep going. I know we have our days where we feel weak and we feel down, but girl, get up, right? I'm praying for God to surround you, just like Moses, surround you with those to the left and to the right of you to hold your arm up so you will have strength, beloved. I love you so much. Sister Kenyatta, yes, have your way, Holy Spirit. That's what we want this morning. I love it. Sister Angela, good morning. So listen, Father God, we just come to you right now in the mighty name of Jesus, acknowledging and recognizing you as the all-powerful God. We recognize that apart from you, we can truly do nothing. Apart from you, we are nothing. And so we just thank you, God, for choosing us. We thank you, God, for using us. We thank you, God, for filling us. We thank you, God, for empowering us. We thank you, God, for loving us. We thank you, God, for providing for us. We thank you, God, for healing us, restoring things, redeeming us, God. We thank you because you truly are a good, 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 good Father. Like the song says, you're perfect in all of your ways. Father God, I don't know the different situations that brings, you know, your sons and your daughters here this morning, but I just thank you that they're here. I thank you that your word transforms, your word heals, your word empowers, your word strengthens, your word gives wisdom and guidance, your word even corrects, God, because sometimes we get off track and we just need you to realign us to what you have called and created us to be. So have your way, good God, that you are. We surrender ourselves to you today. I bind every distraction to include our own thoughts. May we be open to hear and receive from heaven today. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Sister Lisa, good morning. Novlette, good morning. It's good to see you. Do me a favor. Can y'all just, as we get ready to jump into this word, can you click share and let others know that we are about to jump into this powerful word this morning? Because I do believe that this word is for everybody and at any point of our lives. Amen. So let's go ahead and do this thing. I am going to be in, let me get my scripture ready, in 2 Corinthians. This is going to be a very familiar passage to probably most, if not all of us this morning. 2 Corinthians 12. Thank you for sharing. I appreciate that. 2 Corinthians 12, verses 7 through 10. If somebody can put that in the chat for me. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Verses 7 through 10. And I want to say hey to those of you who are watching me via Instagram Live. It's so awesome to see those of you who are not on Facebook, that you prefer to be on Instagram, but you're watching as well. Thank you so much. I so appreciate it. So we're in 2 Corinthians 12, verses 7 through 10. Thank you, Sister Jerianne, for putting it up there for me. I'm going to share it in the Message translation. Hear the word of God. It says, because of the extravagance of those revelations, this is Paul speaking. He said, and so I wouldn't get a big head. I know a lot of us don't think that we may get the big head, but sometimes we really do when we're operating and moving in what we believe is best. And even sometimes when we accomplish things, yes, we work hard, but we can never forget that it is God who blesses us. It is God who gives us favor. It is God who opens doors. It's God who provides resources. So Paul says, so that I wouldn't get a big head, he said, I was given the gift of a handicap to keep me in constant touch with my limitations. First of all, that's just so powerful there, that Paul realizes that he has limitations. And some of us, we really do have to understand that we truly do have limitations. As strong as we are, as in tuned as we are, as smart as we are, as intelligent, as educated, help me, Holy Ghost. You understand? It's nothing wrong with getting those degrees and stuff, but you can never have more degrees than God. And so Paul says, to help me to keep in touch with, God, help me to keep in touch with my limitations. Not that it you know, keeping in touch makes me feel less than, but it reminds me of my constant need to rely upon God. And so he said, I was given the gift of a handicap to keep me in constant touch with my limitations. He said, Satan's angel did his best to get me down, but what he did in fact do was push me to my knees. Come on, somebody. You need to understand that when you feel yourself being down, that sometimes there's no better place than down. Why? Because down humbles us. Down causes us to go to our knees. And guess what we do when we get to our knees? We pray. So he said, Satan, angel tried to push me down, but he didn't realize that he was putting me in the best possible position. I wasn't just down. I was now down on my knees, calling on a great God, my great God, right? So he said, Satan's angel did his best to get me down. But in fact, what he did was push me to my knees. And he said, no danger then of walking around high and mighty. He said, at first, I didn't think of it as a gift, and I begged God to remove it. Have you ever prayed and asked God to remove a thing, to stop a thing, to fix it, to heal it, to give you relief from it? He says, at first, I begged God. He said, I begged God to remove it. He said, three times I begged God to remove it. And this is what he said. He said, my grace is enough. Other translations said, my grace is sufficient. It's all you need. God says, my strength comes into its own in your weakness. When we are weak, then we become strong. Because when we're weak, we realize we run out of our power. But guess what, beloved? When you become weak, that's the time to tap in. Somebody say, God, help me to tap in. What are you tapping into? You're tapping into God's power. He says, my strength comes into its own in your weakness. Paul said, once I heard that, I was glad to let it happen. I love this. He said, once I heard that, I was glad to let it happen because I quit focusing on the handicap and began appreciating the gift. Listen, this is grown folk talk. This is mature Christian talk, right? Because oftentimes we do focus a lot on the handicap. We do focus a lot on the pain. We do focus a lot on the situation. But Paul said, I was able to take my eyes off of the situation and begin to focus on what God was doing. What was he trying to do? What was he allowing? What was he developing? Come on, what was God doing? Even though I couldn't see his hands, I was able to trust his heart. He said, I began appreciating the gift. He says, it was a case of Christ's strength moving in on my weakness. He says, now I take my limitations in stride and with good cheer. He says, these limitations that cut me down to size. And he says, listen, these are some of the limitations he's talking about, limitations that some of us deal with. He says, abuse, accidents, opposition. Come on, anybody has opposition? Bad breaks. Come on, does anybody here have bad breaks? Paul is being real here. He's talking some real language. He says, these things, you know, that cut me down to size. He says, I just let Christ take over. And so the weaker I become, the stronger I become. The weaker I get, the stronger I become. Come on, is there anybody here that's feeling weak in your own power today? Paul says, listen, when we depend upon God, when we truly lean on him, because y'all know, if we can be honest, right, there are times that we are, you know, we start off leaning on God when we really, 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 really need him, right? When things are really, really going bad. Good morning, Sister Gladys. And then when things start to get a little better and we kind of start to find our rhythm and start to find our groove and we're able to start navigating some things, yeah, then we kind of forget about God and start to lean on what? Our own understanding, right? Hey, Sister Phyllis, good morning. And so we have to remember that sometimes when we are feeling weak, we gotta look at our, help me, Holy Ghost. We gotta look at our proximity to God when we're feeling weak. God, I'm feeling weak. Where am I in proximity to you? Have I moved away? Have I started doing my own thing? Have I allowed fear to pull me away? Have I allowed self-sufficiency? Help me, Holy Ghost. Have I allowed shame or guilt or resentment or unforgiveness to pull me away? Because see, all that stuff will place a wedge between us and God. And then we feel some type of way about God, but it's really us that moved away. And now that we moved away, we're feeling weak. So Paul is saying, listen, I've realized that when I feel weak, it's time for me to tap in to the power of God. So in this scripture, I'm sure many of you have heard this scripture before, and the big thing we always talk about is God's grace is sufficient. His grace is sufficient, right? Paul is telling us here that there is a thorn in his flesh. There is a painful situation in his life. Come on, somebody. Anybody dealing with or have dealt with a troubled marriage, right? A rebellious child, a difficult boss, financial hardship, a medical issue, right? You've received a diagnosis. Come on. This is a situation. And have you ever been in that situation where you've asked God to do something about it God, I need you to fix this, God. God, I need you to heal this, God. I need you to remove it. I need you to change it. I need you to do something with this individual. Come on. And the more you prayed, it seems like God didn't do anything about it. Come on. I know I can't be the only one this morning. Right? Where you like Paul, you beg God. You say, God, please. Hey, Sister Vaughn, good morning. God, please. I need you to remove this. I need you to stop this. I need you to step in. And it just don't seem like God is, he's there, but it's like he's not doing anything about it, right? And so the thing is, when Paul asked God to remove it, God didn't just say no, right? Because it's not that he wanted Paul to suffer. It's not that he wants us to suffer, Sister Sandy. It's not that he wants us to suffer, Sister Gladys, right? But he wants us to understand, Sis Penny. He wants us to understand the power of his grace. And can I tell you something? God's grace is not available for us to do what we want to do. Because sometimes that's what we're praying for, God's grace for. God, give me the grace, give me the power, because I want to be able to do this. I want to be able to say this. I want to be able, but God's grace is not available for us to do what we want to do. His grace is available for us to do what he wants us to do. Come on, somebody, right? His grace is not there so that we can look up at ourselves and depend upon ourselves. His grace is available so that we can look to him and depend upon him. So this morning, I just want to speak to you briefly from the topic, the grace to trust God. Somebody put that in the chat this morning. God, give me the grace to trust you, not to trust in myself. God, give me the grace to rely upon you, not to rely upon myself. God, give me the grace to trust you, to trust that you love me, to trust that you take care of me. Get God the grace to trust God. Not trust myself, but to trust God. We pray for God's grace, right? We pray, you know, God, you know, give me the grace so I can speak up. You know, God, give me the grace so I can stand up. God, give me the grace so I can be disciplined. God, give me the, you know, grace so I can set boundaries and all that stuff. But ultimately, y'all, grace gives us the power to not just choose good, but to choose God. Can I say that again? Grace gives us the power not just to choose what is good, but to choose what is God. Because there's a difference. There are a lot of things in life that seem good. The Bible tells us there's a way that seems right unto man, right? There are things in life that seems good, but it's not God. I mean, and I say this a lot of times when I deal with single people, sometimes we're connected to the wrong people. And it's not, and it's hard, help me, Holy Ghost. It's hard to minister to individuals who are dealing with a good person, because that's always the thing. We say, oh, but so-and-so is a good person. Because if we believe that they're a bad person, if they believe that, you know, if we believe that they're a toxic person, if we believe that they are, you know, all those negative things, then it's easier for us to let the relationship go. Am I talking to anybody this morning that when you see all the red flags and stuff, it's easier to let it go? But sometimes you don't, there aren't a lot of red flags and not a lot of flags. There's just one flag. And it's just that one thing deep down in your intuition, in your knower, where you know that even though this is good, it's not God. And anytime we are in a situation or relationship that's good and not God, that means we're compromising, we're settling somewhere, and we're not receiving and walking in the fullness. Somebody say fullness. See, I don't want to just walk in just some things that I, you know, I want the fullness of what God has for me. And that's the difference, good and not God. So ultimately, grace helps us to choose what is God. And we, God, give me the grace, right, to do what you would have me to do. God, give me the grace to say what you would have me to say. Because sometimes what God wants us to say is completely opposite. That, come on, somebody. Have you wanted to say some things that were not very choice? Have you wanted to cuss somebody? Have you wanted to clap back? Have you wanted to give somebody a piece of your mind? And God is telling you that's not what he wants you to say. That's not how he wants you to respond. Grace says, God, where do you want me to go? I know I really want to go here, but where would you have me to be? Grace tells us this is the job to apply for. This is the job. You understand? Oh, but God, you know, I don't feel qualified, but you know, you hear the Holy Spirit saying, this is, grace says, this is the job to apply. Grace says, this is the time to be quiet. I know you could say a whole lot, but grace is saying, be quiet. Because listen, when we seek the grace of God brings in everything else. It includes his wisdom. Come on, it includes his discernment. It includes his favor. It includes his peace. Come on, this is what the grace of God ushers in. And everything we do, beloved, don't you get it twisted for one second. Everything that we do requires God's grace. It requires us to trust God. Hey, Sister Joyce. Hey, Mommy, good morning. Hey, Kenny, good morning. Because let's understand this right off the rip. God has power over all things, spiritual and physical. Do you understand that? Right? I'm not being condescending when I say that. Like we really have to get, when we understand that God has power over all things, we will stop running and moving in fear. We will stop allowing other people to pull us out of the peace that God has for us. Help me, Holy Ghost. You understand? God has power over all things. It's not your boss that has power. It's not your spouse that has power. It's not your rebellious child that has power. Come on, I'm talking to somebody this morning. God has power. Oh, it's not even your job that cuts your paycheck that has power. That's a resource. God is the source, which means God can command any resource to pour into your life at any point. That job is a resource. And so if you lose the resource, God is the source, which means that he can provide another resource. Come on, somebody. This is, I'm praying that this message begins to stir your spirit, because maybe a door has closed and you are lamenting over that closed door, but God owns all the doors. God is the one who opens doors. I know that we are, like I said, we have degrees and we have experience and we have all this stuff, but it is God who has power over all things, spiritual and physical. God rules every situation, every location, every relationship. He has power over all of that. God is amazing and he has wisdom. He's abundant in his grace. His love is unfailing. God is the only one who saves. God forgives. He transforms. Do you need some things to be transformed in your life? Is there someone you're praying for to be transformed? God transforms and God delivers. Come on, somebody. You got to get it in your spirit this morning. God has power over all things. I need you to say that to yourself this morning, because whatever it is that has you fearful, that has you doubtful, that has you feeling weak and defeated, you need to remind yourself this morning, God has power. God has power. God has power over all things. And so we need grace. Somebody said, God, help me to receive your grace this morning. Listen, God's grace is available, but sometimes we just don't receive it. Sometimes we just, you know, we're so, we can be so self-sufficient sometimes, rely upon ourselves. And listen, I understand I have been delivered from perfectionism. And that is, you understand, when you're a perfectionist and you're very strong-willed and you've had to be the tough one for your family and everybody's looked to you. And you see, when we get into all of those things right there, we run the danger. I've had to pull myself up by my bootstraps. In my family, I'm the strong one. I'm the oldest one. When we put ourselves in those situations right there, then we literally are assigning the role of God to ourselves. So we need grace to trust God, right? And here are just a few things we need grace for. Because listen, without the grace, we're not going to do these things. That just fact, you understand? Without God's grace, the gift of his grace. Remember, Paul called it a gift. It's a gift to have the grace of God. We need the gift of the gift of grace to be able to obey God. Somebody say, obey God. I know that seems and sounds simple, but we really do need to desire to obey God. I know this thing looks good over here. I know it sounds good. I know it seems like a good fit. I know, but we just have to obey God, because what God says is always best. Come on, say that. What God says is always best. It's always best. And listen, best does not always mean easiest. I want to say that this morning. A lot of times, best has been the hardest route to go. Real talk. Best has caused people to walk away in my life. Best has caused people to misjudge me. Help me, Holy Ghost. Best has caused people to underestimate me. Best, you understand? What God says is always best. And what he requires is always good. What God says is always best. And what he requires of us is always good. You got to know that, because best don't always look like best. You understand? Sometimes best is wrapped up in the very package that you would otherwise not pay attention to, not want to embrace, not want to connect with. I feel the Holy Spirit. You understand? Sometimes best looks like the harder of the two roads. Have you ever come to a fork in the road? And you know, if you go this way, it'll be comfortable and familiar, which means it's maybe seems a little easier. But if you go this way, it's not that familiar, it's unfamiliar, and you can definitely see there's going to be some discomfort, and you understand, but it is best. Somebody said, God, help me to choose what is best. Sometimes best is walking away from that relationship. Sometimes best is allowing that child to stand on their own two feet. And yes, you may have to watch them fall 3 and 4 and 5 times, but you got to know you are not God. And you cannot, by enabling, you cannot by you know, crippling, you cannot cause that child to come into who God has created them to be by not doing what is best for them. Yes, Sister Joyce, God, help me to choose what is best. We don't want what is easy. We want what is best. We also need grace, listen, to go where God sends us. Because I have news for you. Wherever God sends us, he doesn't just send us, beloved. He doesn't just send us, Quaida. He doesn't just send us, Sister Sandy, Kenyatta. He doesn't just send us. He goes with us. God is all about partnership. Don't be afraid to go where God is sending you, because he is going to go with you. God tells us he never leaves us. He never abandons us. Let's not look at God the way we look at people. If you've ever had, I've had people abandon me. I've had people say they were down with me, and then when the heat turned up, they were not. I've had people say they will go with me, and when I turned around, they weren't there. Come on, somebody. So I'm saying to you that if God sends you someplace, if he tells you to go, then that means his provision, his resources, his grace, his protection, it goes with you. So if he says go, we go, because he will guide us and he will protect us. And when God tells us to do a thing, we have the grace. Say, God, give me the grace to do it without fear. You don't have to be fearful. Fear is not of God. If you are sitting in fear right now, and that fear is causing you to not experience the fullness of God, I come against that fear right now in the name of Jesus. This is not biblical, but I have come to realize it is true, right? Fear, F-E-A-R. False evidence appearing real. F-E-A-R, false evidence appearing real. Does that not sound like the enemy? That the enemy always wants to wrap lies in a way that it looks like it's truth. And you have to ask yourself, when you are, help me, Holy Ghost, when you are operating in the spirit of fear, you want to ask God to help to, God, expose the lie that I am believing. I need you to get this in your spirit this morning, that when we are operating in fear, ask God to expose the false evidence that is appearing real. And then don't stop there. Say, God, expose the lie and reveal the truth. Come on, somebody say that this morning. God, expose the lie. What is the lie that I am believing? And for some of us, it's a lie we've been believing for a long time. It's a seed that the enemy man planted from the time you were a little child. You know, that nobody loves you, that you're not worth it, that you're all by yourself. You know, a spirit of rejection, a seed of rejection. Come on, ask God to expose the lie. The lie is that you are not accepted, that you are not loved, that nobody cares. The truth is, the revelation of the truth is that God loves you, God accepts you. And if you trust him, he will place you around others who loves you and accepts you as well. Come on, somebody. God exposed the lie. Well, the lie is, I believe I will always be in lack. Well, God revealed the truth. The truth is, God provides for all your needs, but not your greed. So it may be that there are things that we are spending on, things that we are doing with our finances, that we're not tithing, we're not being a blessing, but help me, Holy Ghost, but we're buying all this stuff, we're eating out, we're doing all this stuff. And so that's what's causing the lack. And so the lie is that you will always be there, but that's not the truth, because we have a God who is a provider. But then when the truth, the revelation comes, like, okay, God, I need to manage my money different. I need to truly trust you with this thing. I know I have a great job and I'm getting a great paycheck, but God, you're the one that gave it to me. Come on, somebody. Whatever the lie is, I'm telling you right now, in the name of Jesus, God is ready to expose the lie if you will just be willing to receive it and receive it without condemnation. You understand that when we're dealing with the enemy, he is the father of lies. That's all he is. That's all he wants to do every day, beloved, is fill our mind with lies. Cause us to question God. God, and did God really say? That's how he showed up in the garden, and that's how he still is today. Is God really providing? Is God really protecting? Is God really blessing? Will God bless you even though you're still struggling with that sin? Well, come on, somebody. So you need to, in the name of Jesus, God, for your people this morning, expose the lie. And then God, by your loving grace, reveal the truth. A lot of us need some truths to be revealed so that we can release the lie that's causing us to act out, be fearful, doubt God, right? So we need the grace to trust God, because what God has for us is for us. Come on, somebody say that. What God has for me is for me. So stop looking at your neighbor. Stop looking at your sibling. Stop looking at your BFF. Stop looking at that person in church. Stop looking at that person in the other neighborhood. Stop looking at other people and looking at what they have and having a pity party. Oh God, why don't I have this? Why am I not here yet? Why am I not doing this yet? Listen, what God has for you is for you. I have learned to be appreciative of what I have, because what God has for me is for me. It's not for you. It's not for anybody else. It's for me. And if I don't have it, then it's not for me. Come on, somebody. That's big girl talk. That's big boy talk right there, right? That if you don't have it, then it may not be for you, or it may not be for you yet, because we still have some maturing, some developing to do. Come on, somebody. But you got to get it in your spirit. What God has for me is for me. And so that alone will dispel all the lies that you're not worthy, that you miss God, that God is not pleased with you. Come on now. We are dispelling lies this morning. Come on. Anybody rolling with me? Are you dispelling those lies this morning? We are dispelling lies in the mighty name of Jesus. Yes, sis. Blessings always accompany obedience. It is a fact. It's a known fact. So listen, y'all, I just want to encourage you this morning that we are daily in danger of when we forget the power of God and we begin to seek our own purposes and seek our own plans and our own way and in our own timing, right? You know, we convince ourselves sometimes. I know you wouldn't say it, I'm smarter than God, but sometimes the stuff we do says it louder than what we say. You know, when we want to put our hands on stuff, help me, Holy Ghost, when we want to control a thing, when we want to put our mouth on something, right? Maybe it's not for you to say. Just because you know it don't mean you got to say it, right? Sometimes God shows you stuff not to say it, but to pray it. Come on, I'm talking to somebody this morning, right? Sometimes we convince ourselves that it's for us to, you know, put stuff out there, or it's for us to say something and speak up and put a person in their place. No, it's not about what we want to do. It is the grace to trust what God wants us to do. Sometimes we do get into the place where we think that we know better than God, and that's dangerous. A controlling spirit is a dangerous spirit, beloved. We need the grace of God, the grace to trust God, not in ourselves. Because let me tell you something, having faith in ourselves is like trying to navigate a minefield. Y'all know what a minefield is? It's like, you know, a lot of mines. And, you know, if you've ever played the games of a minefield, you got to figure out where to step. And if you step in the wrong, mine, then it blows up. That's literally how our lives look if we are trusting in ourselves. You got to figure out where to step. But when we trust in God, He orders our steps. When we trust in God, He gives us discernment and wisdom. When we trust in God, He puts favor. He opens doors and He also shuts doors. Come on, somebody. When we trust God, He makes a path where there is no path. He makes a way where there is no way. When we trust God, He will connect us to what we need to be connected to and disconnect us from what we don't need to be connected to. When we trust God, He gives us everything we need. Father God, I come to you this morning and I just thank you. I thank you for this word. I thank you that, you know, as Paul said, we complain about the struggles we have. And sometimes, God, we don't even realize that our struggle sometimes is because of our decisions. It's because of our disobedience. It's because we're trusting more in ourselves, God, than we're trusting in you. Sometimes we make it harder on ourselves, the things we say, the words we speak, what we're putting in the atmosphere. We make it harder on ourselves when we rely more upon ourselves than we do upon you, God. We just ask you to forgive us today, God, for not resting in the grace, your grace that you tell us is sufficient, is all we need. And God, I know from experience that when I don't receive your grace, then I'm not able to give it to others, God. I want to be a grace giver today. So to be a grace giver, I have to be able to receive it first. God, I speak grace and more grace over every person watching this live today, watching it now or watching it later. Grace, grace, and more grace. Father God, I'm no longer praying for situations to be removed, from people to change. I'm not praying that. I'm praying for your grace, for me to trust you, even when it doesn't look like it's changing, that I trust you, God. Even when it may not feel like I'm healed, but yet I trust you for my healing, God. My finances don't look good right now, but I trust you to provide everything I need, Father God. This marriage may not look good, but I trust you, God, to intervene and do what only you can do. My son and my daughter, they seem to be lost, but I know they're not lost, God, because you know exactly where they are. I trust you. This relationship that is broken, God, that I wish was better, I trust you. That even though it may not seem like it's being restored, God, I trust you that you're working on the heart of the other person and that you're also working on my heart. God, we trust you today. Give us the grace to trust you and not ourselves today, God. Thank you that your grace empowers, your grace strengthens, your grace fortifies. Hallelujah. Thank you today, God. I speak your grace over every person under the sound of my voice, your sufficient grace that is enough, enough for everything we need. I thank you, Father God. You tell us that when your word goes out, it does not come back to you void. It does not come back to you empty, but it comes back to you decreeing and declaring mission accomplished. I speak that over every person this morning. Thank you, God, for exposing lies and revealing truth. Thank you, God, for just reminding us of our limitations, that we may have limits, but you don't. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You are all powerful. Thank you, God, for your grace to be able to get back up again. Make a U-turn if we're going in the wrong direction. Your grace, your grace, your grace. Thank you for your grace that allows us to forgive others and to forgive ourselves. Your grace, your grace, your grace. So I thank you, Father God, for each person. Bless them, protect them. May your favor be showered on them today as we learn to trust in you, the grace to trust in you today, completely, in Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Listen, I love you all so much, and thank you all for allowing me to speak what God has placed, you know, on my heart today. God is good, y'all, and we need to know that we can trust him. Somebody said, I can trust God. You can trust God. We have put our trust in a lot of other things, but we need to, you're welcome, Sister Joyce. We need to trust God. We need to trust God. Amen. Last thing I'm going to say, for those of you who have been looking at me advertising about this workshop, I Am Enough. You've got 5 days left, beloved, before we close the registration. If you cannot afford the registration fee, which is $10, we have scholarships available. Women have poured in to make sure no person is left behind. So if you're interested and you need a scholarship, please send me an inbox. If not, registration closes in 5 days. It's going to be amazing. Listen, may the grace of God just fill you up today, that you will have everything that you need to be able to be all who God has called and created you to be, not just for yourself, but also to those who need what you have. That as you walk in the fullness of what God has for you, you will be able to be to others what they need to be able to walk in the fullness that God has for them. Amen. I love you all. Have a blessed Friday and an amazing weekend in God's spirit's life. We will be back together again next Friday. Don't forget to click share. If you have not clicked share, please click share and let others know that God's grace truly is sufficient. Amen. Love to all of you. And thank you all for your prayers for me, Willie, my marriage, our family, our children, grandchildren, our ministry, and just everything that God has blessed us with. All right. Love you too, Sister Angela. Have a blessed day, Sister Sandy. You're welcome, Sister Gladys. Love you all so much. Amen, Sister Janice. All right, love you all. Have a blessed day.